Mark Rosset and Michael Stitt came out just a few seconds ago to a smattering of applause. One thing that never ceases to amaze me, David, is how late the French arrive. Here we have a key match, a semi-final of men's singles, and at the moment there must be about 1,500 people watching in this massive stadium.
Ah, yes, but I mean, the French have got their priorities right, haven't they? You know, what's a game of tennis compared with lunch?
True. You could have Agassi against Sampras, and there'd only be a few more here.
Yeah, that's right. It is a peculiar thing. I mean, I always get a little hot under the collar at Wimbledon, where, of course, we don't, in fairness, start there on men's semi-finals day until 1 o'clock rather than 12. But you look around all the hospitality seats, and you know where they are, and blocked off, and you think, well, they're all empty at the start of play, and all the people who've been queuing for weeks, it seems, the genuine tennis enthusiasts are all in. But it is a peculiarity of the French that at the start of play, it's a half empty. It's 7/8 empty.
Yes, I mean, I passed the stadium around 10 o'clock this morning, and there were long queues. But as you say, they weren't queuing up to come on centre court. They were queuing up to go to the hospitality boxes. Well, there you are. Michael Stich, a brand new haircut for a big day. Even for him, this is a massive day. His fifth Grand Slam semi-final. He's been here before. And, of course, he's won a Grand Slam, Wimbledon 91. For Mark Rosset, well, this is absolutely massive. Never before beyond the second round of the French Open. And he is charting new territory here. Mike Morrissey of Britain, the man in charge. Two big men. Michael Stich, 6'4", Mark Rosset, 6'7".
This must be a strange experience for Stich to be out there and see his opponent towering over him.
Yes. Let's talk physique and stamina and the ability to last. Michael Stich's had a relatively easy passage here. Mark Rosset hasn't. Just a couple of days ago, had to come from two sets to love down and very big match against Bernd Carbacher. He won it well. Do you think have totally recovered mentally and particularly physically?
I think so. I mean, obviously, the fact that in the Grand Slam, you get a day off. Of course, the other two, Sampras and Kovalnikov, have had 2 days off. I mean, that is a huge advantage. He'd have just had a fairly gentle hit, probably a very long massage yesterday, both of them. And they'd have hit it, obviously, this morning out here on the centre court with their respective coaches. Mike could be very sensible in putting his hat on. Rosset is less of a natural athlete. He's long, he's gangly. He can at times look remarkably awkward, but he proved that he has the stamina against Carbacher, because that was a long, long match.
It was, 3.5 hours. And he went 5 hours, of course, in the heat of Barcelona to win the Olympic final against Claudio Racy. So we're pretty confident about him. Michael Stich always, to me, looks frail, and his frailty to vulnerability to injury has been proved in the last year, of course, with that run of bad luck on the ankle, which he turned over late last year in Vienna and re-injured earlier this year.
Yes, he's a very slim man, slight of build, long of leg, but I have to say that his form, I think, has been the most impressive of anyone in the championships. The interesting thing for me about Stich is, can he maintain the very relaxed ambiance, almost, if I can use the French word, with which he's playing through this tournament? He said, you know, I only made up my mind at the last minute, mainly because Sven Grunewald, my coach, said, well, look, grass court season is vital for you. The more matches you've had before you get on it, the better. So you're going to play the French. So he came in here with no expectations. He says he's still got no expectations, which frankly is a little difficult to believe, because once you're in the semi-finals of Grand Slam, you must be expecting to do well. I thought that composure was very nearly cracked by Pierlin when he lost the second set. He was moaning about some calls, and he was love 40 down on his serve in the first game of the third set. I think if he'd lost that game, Pierlin had a real chance, but Stich held. He then broke in the next game to go 2-love up in the third, and from then on there was only one winner. So I'll be very interested to see if it gets tough for Michael, whether he can maintain this lovely relaxed feel he has to the tournament.
Yes, for me, he is the most beautiful of the men's players to watch. He's a Rolls Royce of tennis players. Mark Rosset isn't. There's the head-to-head. Never met on clay. Schick won the first two in Stuttgart in 93 on carpet and later that year in Stockholm. First one three sets, the second two. Then in Marseille, they met on the carpet the year later. Rosse won that, a tight one, 6-4 in the third. And then last year in Halle on the grass, Rosse won from a set down, two tie breaks after that, and he won them both. Schick, not a happy bunny. I remember that well.
Yes, and neither of them were happy because having got to the final at Halle, you would think they'd be coming into Wimbledon in good shape. They both lost in the first round.
Yes. Rosse, this enigmatic figure. As he's run through so far. Pretty easy all the way. First round, straight sets. Second round, third round. Quarter final against Stefan, fourth round against Stefan Edberg, straight sets. And then he ran into Carbacher, who for a long while looked to have his measure, but started to show some frailty at the end of the second set, which he just won. And then afterwards, couldn't cope with Rosse. Rosse starting to come in more, looking more aggressive, and finished him off comprehensively, 6-love in the fifth. And Michael Schick, a couple of early three-setters against Patrick Fredriksson of Sweden and then Brit Greg Grzeczy. Then things started to get tougher. Michael Tielstrom took a set off him. A really good win, the win of the year for him against Thomas Muster, a champion here, of course, winning in four sets. And then the match David was talking about against Cedric Pioline, also in four.
Tactically, it'll be very interesting to see if Rosse continues to play the way he did against Carbacher in the third set. I mean, he turned it around. He said, well, look, I've got to do something different. So I'm going to attack more. I'm going to come into the net more behind my serve. And it made a huge difference, obviously. I imagine that Stieg is going to serve and volley behind something like 80-75% of his first serves. He won't come in every time, he'll mix it up a bit. He'll probably stay back most of the time behind the second, but come in and occasionally. So we know how Stieg is going to play. I'll be interested to see how Rosse plays. The problem for anyone, as we look at Rosse's record, which is awful, never got before the second round, as you were saying, Simon. And remember, he's won five matches to get to this round.
Yeah. To get to this round. It was 1-3, lost 6 before he started this year.
Absolutely. The problem for Rosse is, where do you attack Stieg? Because the forehand, which he's altered, is a great shot now. The backhand, we know, is a fabulous shot. Whereas Stieg has got something obvious. Rosse's backhand is not in the same class as his forehand.
Yes, one or two backhand winners we saw from Rosse across court. There's the semi-final lineup. Michael Schick asking for Bruno Robert, the head of the umpires, and a couple of his friends to move out of his eye line.
This is Gilbert Sherm, who's down there, the tournament referee. He was actually in that match against Pioline, complaining that cameras were popping up in that little section and distracting him, because obviously... And he's asking now no portable phone, so already maybe he's a little... Yep.
This doesn't sound like a guy who's got no expectation of himself. It's a good gambit, because it seems to put no pressure on yourself. Everything is a bonus. And Schick has come in there, and I'm sure his frame of mind might have been like that last Monday.
Yeah.
But it's not like that now.
It shouldn't be, and I'm sure it isn't. The Swiss are having a good tournament, aren't they? Apart from Rosse, Jakob Plasics in the final of the doubles. He and Guy Fourchet beat the number one seeds, the Woodies, yesterday.
Big day for Switzerland. No Swiss player has ever reached a semi-final of a Grand Slam tournament in the Open era. In singles, Stefan Oberer, Marc Rosse's coach on the right there. And Mike Morrissey obeying Schick's wish that portable phones should be switched off. They'd write too.
Demi manche. Service, Michael Schick.
Sure.
Premier pass, s'il vous plaît.
So here we go then. Michael Schick against Marc Rosse. The first semi-final in the men's singles French Open 1996.
15-0.
Well, signs that Rossi may be a little nervous, mistiming the ball badly on the first two points.
Oh. 40-0. Just
talking to Frew about this yesterday, about how long it takes for nerves generally to settle down. It varies from player to player. He thought around 4 or 5 games. Stick giving the player hard look.
40.
Impressive serving, and the German gets off to a useful start.
Sport, the fragrance and skin fitness line by Ralph Lauren.
This wall covers a lot of ground. It goes on forever. Nothing gets past. And when I play, I am the wall. I'm Michael Chang, and this is my plan.
Campari, never by chance.
Mark Rossi about to serve. Love one down in the opening set. Rossi, who's quickest serve this fortnight, 204 Ks, joint third. Joint top is the man in picture, 205, Stick and Richard Krajicek. These are matches only on centre and the Suzanne Longlong court, so Greg Rozetsky didn't figure. But everybody else who we'd think might is in the frame. Translated into miles an hour, Stick's is 127.4, Rossi's 126.8. Yes, a bit of breeze, a bit more than when we began, which will be welcome. Not that they get too much of it down there.
No, like all great stadiums, it's pretty much protected by the high stands.
Lost his footing.
I also think, Simon, he didn't think it was coming over. I think he thought it was going into the net.
Yes.
Suddenly realised and then tried to react and, as you say, slipped.
It's a beaut. Every shot he makes is a thing of beauty. First ace.
Un jeu partout.
Yes, Rossi is effective rather than beautiful, but there's hardly an inelegant move about anything that Stick does. Oh. There's the first phone. And Rossi very quick to counter the original call and getting warmly applauded for that. On the line it was. And Stick recognising he's playing a real sportsman. One of the most popular players on the circuit is Rossi, amongst his peers. Until he plays shots like that, and then opponents forget to like him.
Yes, I think the magic magnifier showing that the shot from Stieg was indeed right on the line. It's one thing that's been a feature of the tournament, actually. We've had very few major rows, including Andre Agassi. Came within a point of being disqualified, and that's about it.
Yes. Yes, last year, I remember a little bit, Magro with Becker and Voynea, Bruguera and Magnus Larsen.
Yeah. Weather helps.
Yes.
Players love to know that they're going to play. Last year, if you remember, it was wet, it was cold, it was miserable, and they had a lot of hanging around in the locker rooms, and everybody gets a bit tetchy in those circumstances.
Premier service.
Well, most of the Stieg error is coming off the forehand at the moment, and the forehand troubled him a little against Pierlin in the last round.
Avantage Stieg.
Rossi's returning, just letting him down a little there. So Stieg moves to a 2-1 lead. Marc Rossi, 1-2 opening set. First semi-final of the French Open to come. Sampras and Kafelnikov. To have a look. Rossi says it's long. Stieg still keen that Mike Morrissey should go down there. Long it is. Not by that much. Has a double to go with the ace in the opening game.
Oh. Antoine Rosset.
And again, the error on the forehand from Stick, which I think is beginning to frustrate him.
He's shortened the backswing, unlike Rosset, who has this mammoth swing on his forehand, and he winds it up. Changed the grip just a fraction. Stick, he has a habit of just coming over the top of the ball. Most of his errors will be into the net.
Well, it wasn't the greatest drop shot in the world. And Rossi got there with ease, but the execution wasn't much.
Yes. That's really an escape for Stieg, because he was way far too back to be playing a drop shot well behind the baseline.
Approach and a touch volley into the corner.
Rosse really stretched him both ways, and you could see he was having to try and catch up with the ball. And this is where Stieg is glorious, a lovely variation. He can play every single backhand on the in the book, slice or topspin.
Never wears a hat, Rossi. Even in the 5 hours of the final in Barcelona. Disrespect for the serve.
Watch the ground Rosse makes here. He's moving, he's determined to get the big forehand into play. And for a big man, he had to get out of the way of the ball very quickly.
Well played. It was a tester. Rosse got it down.
40-30.
Rosse, a one-handed drive backhand. You won't see many of those. He plays most of his drive backhands double-handed, and then a one-handed slice.
First ace for the German. Still with serve. 3-2. Here on centre court, Michael Stieg in his second semi-final at Roland Garros. He lost to Jim Courier in 1991, four sets. Courier, of course, went on to win the title that year. Marc Rosse, 2-3, first set.
Stieg really forced back deep by the length of the Rosse forehands. The slice that time, and he tried to come over the drive when he made the error.
Yeah, well played. Rosse getting into a groove now. With his big forehand and starting to manoeuvre Stieg around.
jeu pour C.
Second ace.
Bon jeu partout.
Three games each, and Rosset now settling down. Looking very much at home. We mentioned they seem to have little feel in the opening game. Nerve perhaps telling their own story, but definitely relaxed out there now.
Winning his opening service game comfortably was very important to him. He's actually won three more points in the match, which is a signal of the fact that he's holding serves the easier.
It's another majestic sight, isn't it, the Schick overhead?
Yes, he doesn't miss many, gets into position. See how quickly he turns sideways on. And the left hand goes up as if pointing to the ball, as if he was throwing it up.
Now, if Rossi can get returns like that going, then he has a major chance here. Turn a serve, if it can be consistent, could well turn this match. Now Schick is having to play catch-up. I see one service break as probably being decisive in this.
You would imagine so, and yet in the Schick-Pirin match, we had four in a row at one stage.
Yes.
30.
Two aces each. Coming into serve and volley. There's Jessica. Can applaud as loudly as she likes. There was a little section of the crowd who weren't too happy with the way the Germans were supporting Schick against Pialin, and the French were beginning to barrack the little German enclave. Won't be like that today.
Premier service.
Tremendous rally. Rossi looking down at that mark down there. Still not particularly happy with it. But Schick has taken the game and leads 4-3.
Polo Sport, the fragrance and skin fitness line by Ralph Lauren.
Those players shielded from the sun by umbrellas during the change round, and welcome relief it must be too. 22 minutes gone. Schick leads 4-3.
First time in the match, the first point of the service game has gone against the server. And sometimes in a tight match, immediately you think, interesting.
Majestic shots again from Schick, and really making Rossi work. So now it's love 30. And a change of racket.
And particularly worrying for Rossi is that Schick made two superb forehands in that particular rally. drew Rossi out wide to the forehand and therefore exposed his weaker wing. That's what Schlick has to do. Rossi loves to run round and play with the forehand from the backhand corner.
Not quite. Everything right about the shot and the way it looked. Just an inch or so the wrong side of a line.
Yes, it was that hook shot that only the really best players can do. They're hooking it round with a little bit of side spin and didn't have quite enough. Round the ball as well as through it.
His quickest serve so far, 196 Ks. And here's the first break point of the match so far.
Metz, premier service.
That was an overrule from Mike Morrissey. There was no call from the net court judge, but no protest from either player.
Oh. Nope, it's long. And Schlick strikes here at just the right time. After 25 minutes, he now serves for the set.
Exactly the same as in the match with Pierlin. He broke for 5-3 in the first set. Mind you, he was broken back to 5-4 and then broke again to get the set.
Oh, yes. And you could hear the acknowledgement from Schlick way before the ball bounced, almost as it passed him.
Too short the approach, it was only just beyond the service line, and that gave Rossi the time to make the pass.
Lovely volley.
Cancel.
The weight distribution wasn't perfect, but he manufactured the shot terrific.
And he got the perfect direction, and Rossi was hoping he'd get a nice short ball to his forehand. Suddenly he had to turn, and that's tough when you're 6-7.
That's wide. Rossi knows he has to put pressure on Schlick, and he's doing so. Really upset with himself, can the Swiss. Return just good enough. Not sure about how much of the sweet spot of the racket he got onto it, but it worked.
It was one of those annoying ones. Miss hit. Was he going to go out? Schlick was hesitating, decided to play it.
So after one break, it's Rossi now who has his first break point. Can be his own man sometimes, but he was giving Schlick an awful lot of centre there.
Still brave though, isn't it? Your break point down, you're serving for the set, and he offers it to you and you take it. A lot of people would have just copped out, as it were, and gone for the safe serve.
Third ace. Well played, Rossi. Oh, That's tough. Really tough, because that stick shot could really have gone anywhere.
It was stick out the racket and hope, if you'll excuse the pun on the German's name. And it landed on the line.
So here, after 29 minutes, is set point. A little fortunate. Michael Stick, a set up against Marc Rosset. He'll be back. Michael Stick has an ice bucket alongside him and plenty of ice in a towel which he had round the back of his neck during the last change round. Even though things are going very well, he's aware. And Sean McEnroe says we could be here for a while. So he's taking all the precautions.
A little bit of extra time, of course, during that change of ends as the court was dragged and the line swept.
Very high first serve percentage, 75 for Rossi, and he's the one who's been broken. Perhaps we shouldn't have pointed it out.
Talking of John McEnroe, there he is. Commentating here for American television.
Is this just the technique faulty for a moment, or disappointment showing itself?
That was certainly technique. I mean, he's a huge man. He's got to get the ball up. He hardly threw that second serve ball up at all.
Now, what is happening? Sometimes his head can go wandering. Often in press conferences, we ask him what's gone wrong. Is it a forehand, backhand? He goes, nope, my head. And the head seems to be a little adrift from the rest of him at the moment. And here are three break points. Terrific pass. But what on earth was going on in Rosset's head in that game? Suddenly, it's a mountainous task. All the theorising in the world sometimes will get you no nearer the truth as far as Marc Rosset is concerned, so we just have to watch and try and make our own interpretations. It's a set and one love to Stick at the moment. But just as quickly as he switched off, he might switch back on again. And then we have a contest again.
0-15.
It's catching. Stick's first double.
It's the forehand that is deserting Rosset at the moment. I mean, this was a comparatively easy pass. You can see he's got plenty of time. It's a short shot from Stieg. And you would expect Rosset to make that 9 times out of 10.
Yes, even off balance, he still looks elegant and he can still put it away.
Backhand down the line is a very useful shot against Rosset because, again, he's always edging over to that backhand side.
And just as Rosset's form is beginning to dip, or certainly has plummeted, Stix is rising all the time.
And so important that it should, because when you sense that your opponent has gone walkabout doing an Yvonne Goolagong, you've got to grind him down.
Well, Rossi is out of this match at the moment. Four games in a row. In fact, five. Five in a row to Michael Stieg. It's absolutely vital that Rosset wins this. Otherwise, again, he's going to have to come back from two sets to love down. Which is one thing against Bernd Carbacher, another against this German.
He's got a little ahead of himself on that shot, Stieg. He was ready to play it, and then the ball hadn't got to him yet.
Tyriak, puffing away.
Yes, his mate and former doubles partner, Mr. Nastasi, didn't do too well in the election.
Is that right? Didn't follow the... I thought he was going to do well.
Yes, everybody did, but he came a very distant second.
Did he?
Good, Rosset.
Mark Rosset is back with us, but he's left himself a lot to do in this set. 2-1 Stieg, he leads by a set. Centre court filling up. You can see the president's box. They're still eating away in the village, but along the sides and at the ends, we're just over half full now. I think around 7,000-8,000 people in.
The Hawkins.
Radar gun in, he had that as 162. I have to say, I don't have complete trust in it.
No, it does come up with some very strange readings from time to time.
30, 15.
It's got that at 104.
Yes.
I sure like, don't believe that.
It's more like 204. Doing early on, Rosset, playing those forehands from the backhand court and doing it well. Terrific play. Rosset looking down the court at him as if to say, there's not a lot I can do if you play like that.
No, Rosset did nothing wrong in this. It's superb anticipation from Stieg. He's covering the down the line. He was standing on that side of the court. He was offering Rosset the cross court. If he could have made it, it was too good.
Oh, and so is that. Michael Stieg in regal form. Yes, any cover will do here.
Duck by the looks of it. Not weather for ducks, thank heavens. Had a nice bit of canard last night though.
Please. 1-3. While I was working on the highlights, David was at a party, and another party tonight, David.
Tough life we lead, isn't it?
You lead.
Ken's up. Deuxième service.
Right now, what's he?
30-15.
Yes, look, Streaky's in absolutely the perfect position there. He's got it covered. He could have pushed it back down the line or cut it cross court.
Third ace for Rossi. He made him suffer there in every way. That was an exhausting rally for Rossi.
And this is the thing about Stieg. I mean, because he's a Wimbledon champion, we think of him primarily as a serve and volleyer, but you watch him hit forehands and backhands like this. He's a beautiful ground stroker as well.
If he stays fit, Michael Stieg, with this new attitude he has, it seems to me he could yet become number one in the world. Not beyond the realms of possibility. If he should win on Sunday, it would really make him move again.
Yes, that wasn't it wasn't actually a net cord, it was something blew off I think Michael Stieg's chair, a towel or something, so Mike Morrissey has ordered a let first service.
Rossi playing really well again, but still having to pay for that errant behaviour in the opening game. It's 3-2 Stieg. Michael Stieg asking for a replenishment of his ice bucket. He's used it frequently and wants a constant supply. Nothing is going to chance.
Surprised it is now 32 degrees. We started at 30, so we're now up at, that's exactly 90, isn't it? 32.
Yeah.
90 Fahrenheit.
Certainly seems like it. Stieg then 3-2. He's got a break and he's got a set as well. Oh.
Rossi throws everything into that forehand and yet he has to make another.
Kenza. trente quinze. Premier service.
Far away. Still serving really well.
Yes, he's got 73% of his first serves in this set, in the match, but in this set. 66 in the match, that's still terrific.
Yes, 4-2. And you mentioned rightly so, David, earlier on, that he's much more than a serve and volleyer shtick. But if the serve's working well, it helps everything else, doesn't it? He's more relaxed about everything.
Yes, he's got so much more of a complete game. The other interesting statistic, I mean, Rosse has only won 2 points at the net in the entire match so far. Shtick's won 10. So Rosse has really got to win with the big forehand or the serve. Shtick can win with anything.
2-4. Well, there came a time against Carbaker when Rosse decided that he had to move up more, and it worked. He was making some good volleys. Carbaker, yes, he did wilt a little. There may come that time here. It's the one shot perhaps that's not been as good as he might have hoped it would be, that backhand down the line. The problems on the forehand now seem to have gone. Terrific play from Michael Shtick.
Ignoring the obvious shot and getting the backhand down the line, or even the off backhand, working that one, the in-to-out backhand, and completely surprising Rosse, who was expecting the cross court, of course. And again, he has to stick out a racket and lunge.
40-15.
Four aces each now. Shtick says it's okay, don't worry about that. Very sporting encounter so far. Shtick leads it, 4-3, second set.
Shtick même pas 4 jeux à 3.
Shtick in the driving seat here, leads by a set in the break he got early on in the opening Rosse service game in the second set. It's 4-3, the winner to play either Sampras or Kafelnikov, who play right after this. That match also live here on Eurosport. Shtick with new balls.
Yes. 6-0.
Big weekend of Eurosport, of course. We've got the Euro start of Euro 96. The thing that occurs to me, if it's like this at Wembley tomorrow, the players are really going to suffer.
Swiss involved there again, aren't they?
Yeah. Not too involved, I hope.
As a Welshman, I can stay neutral.
47.
I would hope so.
Well, yes, I wouldn't back the Swiss.
Well, it's hardly looking any better than that forehand, which you marked out early on as being a bit of a problem. He seems to have worked it out now.
He certainly does. As you pointed out, he's missed a few backhands down the line. It's funny enough, a shot that Yevgeny Kovalnikov has struggled on during the championships, but the forehand is now working sweetly. Of course, now he's not under the same pressure as at the start of the match, and that's a factor.
Rossi serving to stay in the second set now. Well, didn't he deserve that? Terrific defence from the Swiss.
Dan Settle.
He turns it round well.
Yes, he was under all sorts of attack with those forehands, getting down very low to make the volleys. Great leap to the back end.
Blaming himself, but it was a scything slice, wasn't it, from Stig?
Yes, it was always going to keep low, and I think he may have caught the line. He did. He just caught the inside edge of the line, and yes, it became a real shooter.
Stig's playing really well. Rossi's just got to do what he can, concentrate on his good points, and try and force the game, but Stick's going to return like this. There's not an awful lot he can do. Stick's now 2 points in the set.
Trotter.
So he's not alone, Rossi.
Yes, I was surprised by that call.
Line judge, I have to say, is having a difficult time down there.
And you've got to say this is a huge slice of luck for Rossi because he lost that point. He'd be set point down.
Yes. No wonder Stick's upset. And that's what happens. Michael Stick of old would have got pretty upset with life. So thunders down a couple of first serves. And now Stick has got to serve out for the set. And you'll see that in a moment. So a big moment for Michael Stick. David pointing out there's been a change in the way the officials are situated now.
Yes, the baseline judge at this end has been moved, taken off that line, put on an easier line, the centre service line, because, as you pointed out in the last game, he's been struggling a bit and just has taken the pressure off him.
Stick serving for a two-sets lead.
And you can bet that Stick will have noticed the change as well.
And that he didn't have to ask for it. Well, you wouldn't believe there's any tension there. There may not be, but everything looks so well oiled.
Yes, the Rolls-Royce you were talking about, and the engine is purring perfectly.
Just the occasional splutter.
There's in the petrol, of course.
Well played, Rosset. Yes, two terrific shots. Great return.
15-30.
Yes, that was the shot that made it difficult for Stieg. Half volley, couldn't get it deep enough, and Rosset quick enough on those long legs of his to run round the back end.
It isn't life easy when you can fire down a serve like that. Turn, set it up. Excellent stuff from Rosset. Break point.
So two break points in the match, both when Stieg's been serving for sets.
Back, he went for the whole lot here. That's his nature. He's done pretty well with it. Keep the serve and volley. So screaming, the new baseline judge giving the call, and here is set point for Michael Stieg for a two sets lead. Another rasping return.
He has returned well because there have been 8 points so far in this game, and Stieg's got 7 first serves in. I mean, he's not seizing up. It's just Rosset is playing superbly.
A really clever second serve. Sure, if that came off the line from Rosset's movements, you'd think it might have, yeah. Kicked high.
Just Michael blowing a little bit. He knew he's a little close for comfort with the second serve.
Set point again. Oh! No, it's gone long. I thought for a moment it might have landed in, but long it was, and for the second match in succession, Marc Rossi has got to come back from two sets down.
Well, if the shot hadn't got in, it would have been the shot of the tournament. My word, he missed it by a whisker.
So my instinct was that he got it, but no argument. Well, he's been here before, Rossi, quite recently on this very court. Didn't think he'd do it then. I have to say, I don't think he'll do it now. Then there was a considerable help, I'm afraid, from his opponent. Get none here.
0-30.
And none from the margins either. Everything's just going a little away from him.
Of course, you know, played a bad service game, started the second set, and that was the second set gone. That 30 hasn't broken the Stieg serve in the match.
Well, the tables turned there. That time, Michael Schick was on the end of a bit of string. Didn't he react well? And no wonder she's delighted.
Fascinating there. There was Rossi winding up these huge shots, hammering the ball, and Schick at the other end sort of just pushing and prodding and timing it.
Three break points. And overall, again, not a murmur from Russell. Well, the smash just mishit. The volley wasn't. And Rossi is now in terrible straits. Schick, as he did in the second set, breaks right at the start of the third. Time's gone by in situations like this. Mark Rossi, like Michael Schick, used to hang his head and give the impression it was just one of those days. Rossi's a different character now. He showed it against Carbacher, but it's going to be even tougher here against Michael Schick, who's playing absolutely superb.
Yes, you feel almost at the moment that the only hope Rossi's really got is that Stig says, oh, there you are, I'm in the final, and starts looking ahead, playing the result instead of the points.
Oh, and that was the shot that was going wrong.
Almost time to hoist the white flag in admiration, one feels. This is just brilliant.
There is no answer to tennis like this. Rossi just looks at him. He's played pretty well, Schick, through the fortnight, but this is as good as it gets.
8 points played in this set. Schick's won the lot. And he won every single point of this last game with sheer perfection.
What has Mark Rossi done to deserve this?
0-15.
You could say Rossi was too short with the approach, but he was going with the angle.
Schick read him like a book. Time for real mental strength here for Rossi. It's a very public humiliation at the moment. Schick cannot continue to play tennis like this for much longer. Rossi must believe that. He gets a call. Schick wants to have a look.
Yes, I must confess, I'm not surprised. I actually thought he'd hit the line. And yes, he hit, and he had.
Play it again. Well, the crowd giving Rossi the sympathy vote.
But the replay shows quite clearly right on the line, and Rossi, no murmur once again. Every decision in this match has been accepted with good grace.
To his credit, he's trying to be brave. He's now deciding to come in and pressure stick, try and disrupt the rhythm.
Yeah, what he's got to say to himself, and you made the point a moment ago, is look, it's not I'm playing badly, it's just this guy's playing out of his mind.
Three break points for three love. At last.
First 11 points of the set to Stieg.
Fifth ace. If he can get out of this hole, start to rebuild again. You never know. Two breaks down. Surely would be curtains. Stieg now is roaring home. Two sets, three love. So a big moment for Michael Stieg. David pointing out there's been a change in the way the officials are situated now.
Yes, the baseline judge at this end has been moved, taken off that line, put on an easier line, the centre service line, because, as you pointed out in the last game, he's been struggling a bit. Just taking the pressure off him.
Stieg serving for a two sets lead.
And you can bet that Stieg will have noticed the change as well.
And he didn't have to ask for it. Well, you wouldn't believe there's any tension there. There may not be, but everything looks so well oiled.
It's the Rolls-Royce you were talking about, and the engine is purring perfectly.
Hands up.
Just the occasional splutter.
There's in the petrol, of course.
Well played, Rossi. Yes, two terrific shots. Great return.
Yes, that was the shot that made it difficult for Stieg. Half volley, couldn't get it deep enough. And Rossi quick enough on those long legs of his to run round the backhand.
Isn't life easy when you can fire down a serve like that? Turn, set it up. Excellent stuff from Rossi. Break point.
Set two break points in the match, both when Stieg's been serving for sets.
Back, he went for the whole lot here. That's his nature. He's He's done pretty well with it. Just a serving volley. Also screaming, the new baseline judge giving the call. And here is set point for Michael Stich for a two sets lead. Another rasping return.
He has returned well because there have been 8 points so far in this game and Stich's got 7 first serves in. I mean, he's not seizing up. It's just Rosse is playing superbly.
A really clever second serve. Not sure if that came off the line from Rosse's movements. You'd think it might have, yeah. Kicked high.
Michael blowing a little bit. He knew he's a little close for comfort with the second serve.
Set point again. Oh! No, it's gone long. I thought for a moment it might have landed in, but long it was. And for the second match in succession, Marc Rossi has got to come back from two sets down.
Well, if the shot hadn't got in, it would have been the shot of the tournament. My word, he missed it by a whisker.
So my instinct was that he got it, but no argument. Well, he's been here before, Rossi. Quite recently, on this very court. Didn't think he'd do it then. I have to say, I don't think he'll do it now. Then there was a considerable help, I'm afraid, from his opponent. Get none here.
0-30.
And none from the margins either. Everything's just going a little away from him.
Of course, you know, he played a bad service game, started the second set, and that was the second set gone. At 30, hasn't broken the streak serve in the match.
Turn there. That time Michael Stich was on the end of a bit of string. Didn't he react well? And no wonder she's delighted.
Fascinating there. There was Rossi winding up these huge shots, hammering the ball, and Stich at the other end sort of just pushing and prodding and timing it.
Three break points. Overall, again, not a murmur from Rossi. Well, the smash just miss hit, the volley wasn't, and Rossi is now in terrible straits. Stich, as he did in the second set, breaks right at the start of the third.
Reprise.
David, as I was coming here, I was working out the path that each man had made to get through to the semi-final. I was thinking, well, Stich's had a pretty easy draw, really. Not really been tested. And then I looked down, I thought, hold on, he's beaten Muster.
Yes. And he beat Teelstrom as well, who's a very fine player, who himself beat Muster in the Australian Open this year. But, yeah, I mean, to beat Muster on clay.
And It's a bit of a cliche, but as we went into the tournament, I think most of us thought whoever beats Muster wins the tournament, and it's probably going to be in the final, if anybody, it's going to beat Muster. Well, he beat him earlier on, and it looks like he's through at least to the final. Not there yet, though. Everything's going his way.
Yes, people have lost from these situations, but you just can't see it at the moment. He's the luck's on his side, but he's made his own luck.
I asked him at the press conference after the match against Tilstrom about the preparation. Can you prepare too much? And he said, yes, you can. He said, for someone like me, as long as I'm hitting the ball well and feeling good about my game, the rhythm's right, yeah, there's a danger you could go stale. And it's a question of peaking at the right time. It looks like he might have. But if guys like he and Sampras, who's played as little as he has on the clay, can get to the finals, it looks like Stick's virtually there. Not good news for the tournaments leading up to the French.
No, it could rewrite the preparations. Both of them just played two matches on clay before the French. But it has to be said, obviously, the weather has been a very important factor in the demise of the clay court experts. It really has favoured the big hitters.
And to be fair, Stick had a fairly easy draw early on when it was vital.
Yeah.
By the time he came up against Muster or even Tilstrom, who was going to be a danger, he'd had a couple of matches.
Yes, in the third set against Fredriksson in his very opening round, he was puffing and panting. And if the Swede could somehow have won that third set and it went 7-5 or even a tiebreak, yeah, it could have been interesting.
Yeah, 7-5 second. It's love four here.
Cancel.
That's how he started. Four hands like that.
I bet Rossi was half expecting a puff of wind to blow up and just get it on the line. It's been that sort of a day for him.
At last, the conquering hero. Five games in a row against him, but he's going again. Michael Stick. He's played like a god here, and he's within two games, perhaps, of getting to his third Grand Slam final.
Next,
finalist in the US Open, 94. Lost to Agassi then, and a Wimbledon champion, of course, in 91.
Cancel.
I don't think it could have been many matches in which Stick has played better than this.
No, it's been quite brilliant. It's been as good as he was at times against Tilstrom. And the ball seems attracted to his racket now, like a magnet. He's there wherever Rosset goes.
35.
Arrived just in time for the end of the match.
Well, better go off and have a drink. There's anything as short as that has been punished as ruthlessly as that. Seventh ace, Stick now a game away.
I'll tell you what it's reminding me now of, Simon, in particular in this set where he's just raised his game to a whole new plane, of McEnroe against Connors in the 84 final, which obviously, because I umpired it, I remember vividly.
Yes, I remember
and,
it too.
And people said to me afterwards, weren't you disappointed it was so one-sided? And I said, look, McEnroe played like a dream all match. How can anybody be disappointed with that? And the way Stick has played in this third set has just been unbelievable.
New balls. Rosse hoping for new luck. Serving to stay in the match. Yes, I remember that match well. Connors did very little wrong and he was slaughtered. Just creamed it. He's kept trying, Rossi, and he must be given credit for that. It's so hard when so little works.
Oh. And even harder when your opponent's mishits land on lines.
Yes. Stick up. Acknowledges his luck and then, as if to rub it in, hits a dream of a backhand. And here, after what, just an hour and 27 minutes, but it's just flown by even quicker than that. It's been a privilege to watch. And it's match point to the German. I'd love to know what's going through his head right now. Oh, well, I guess he might have guessed it.
But it was like a guy faking the goalkeeper on a penalty, wasn't it? The goalie's dived the other way and he hasn't kicked it yet. And he sort of pushes it into the other corner.
Yeah. Match point number two.
Egalité.
Sixth ace. only Rosso's fourth double. Stich. And here's match point number three. Still not happy. Just to play one more, just to feel the touch. This touch has been dreadful. No, no. It's all right. Nothing wrong with that. On the line, surely. Find that one, and you're a better man than me. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, that's very handy, that magnifying glass, and you can see it was right on the line.
Rossi.
Right down the centre.
Still, Stich won't let him go. Two sets up, 5-1 up.
It's the fourth deuce, making this by far the longest game of the match. Previous was the last game of the last set, which had two.
No, not that time. And then Rosse doing to Stich what Stich's been doing to him, reading him so well.
Avantage Rosse.
Right here. Well played, Mark Rosse. A game of character for him, and he can be proud of himself. So this is it, as far as Mark Rosse is concerned. This is where the big fight back starts. Two breaks down, should be the last rights. Rosse recovered dramatically well against Carbacher. Can't see it happening here.
Can settle.
Sticks. Serving percentage for the match, 68%. For this set, 75.
Premier service.
It's ridiculous. First serve percentage in this set, 77. Well, there's no answer. Here are three more match points. This is match point number four. It's okay.
Garante Gans.
I like the look in Ross's eye. If he misses the next one, he might not feel so good about life. Five match points missed now. It's been a near perfect set. It's not a perfect ending. The new Michael Stich is through to his third Grand Slam final. But poor Marc Rosset, on his biggest day of his life, to come up against a player playing very near perfect tennis. Perfection is something to strive for on a tennis court. You'll never attain it, but Stich went a long way towards attaining it there.
Well, you summed it up, Simon. It was just a privilege to be able to witness it. And, yeah, there's Sven Grunewald, the new coach, hugging Jessica Stich. I'm delighted for Sven. He's a man I've got to know over the last few years, and he is a lovely, lovely man. But I tell you, whoever Stich plays in the final, and however well they play, if Stich plays like he did in that third set, he'll win. It's simple. I mean, no one, no one... to